My pleasure to welcome you here today. On behalf of the M&A Advisor, our alliances, our sponsors, and our partners, it's my pleasure to welcome you to the 2015 International Financial Forum and the first event of today, our Cross-Border M&A Symposium. Our opening session today will be led by Global Investment Advisor and Columbia Professor Marshall Sonnenschein with four notable international investors. In 2011, the idea of a white paper originated in a conversation with Merrill DataCite. That idea has become the best practices of the best dealmakers guide. Today, almost 200 contributors have collaborated with us to develop a series for which we have just published the second book. We have hosted 12 sessions across these forums. We have published installments every 60 days, and we are now expanding that program into Europe and the rest of the primary M&A markets. I'm very fortunate to have a contributor, collaborator, guide, and often muse in Marshall Sonnenschein, who's worked very tirelessly with us to advance this cause. And Marshall will kick off today's session with the assembly of a group of individuals who are truly at the front line, on the front line, and on trains, planes, and automobiles through their pioneering efforts in cross-border M&A. We bring this group together at a time of cautiously and imperfectly resuming growth in economic markets, but also at a time for reglobalization for business generally. Indeed, reglobalization has been so successful that it's actually slowing the top-line growth of America's largest companies for the simple reason that those foreign revenues need to be translated into dollars, which trade at strong levels, and relative to many of the foreign currencies, which has become an interesting irony of this modern business era. The group that we've assembled here today truly understands the dynamics of reglobalization and international deal-making. They're all highly established deal makers who've been globetrotting for many years. I'd like you now please welcome the panel to the stage as I introduce Marshall Sonnenschein further. Marshall, as many of you know, is the chairman of the global banking firm Sonnenschein Partners. He's a professor at Columbia University, and it's our pleasure to have this group kick off the forum. Gentlemen, if you'll join us now.
The one thing that was absolutely the common theme running through the really wonderful group of panelists that I was asked to moderate today is globality. It is a sense of markets that transcend borders, and it's a sense of political and geopolitical issues that affect markets and companies. I would also add, for good measure, but also for something maybe more substantively important, I think it's a group of people who understand companies as human enterprises. And I assert that and emphasize it because I think there's a tendency sometimes as we all globetrot and try to do deals, make things happen, move companies, move money, move securities, there's sometimes a tendency to commoditize the company in our minds. And yet the company is a human enterprise. It is constituted of human beings who go to work every day, who manufacture goods or produce services that other people rely on, and that therefore becomes part of something we call an economy, which is a critical part of something we call a civilization. And I think the people here on this particular panel have some sensitivity to that game within the game of M&A, deal-making, and business. Now, those people to whom I refer are as follows. On my left, if I can be somewhat reductionist with these global folks, on my left are the people who are perhaps most connected to the Far East. And those are Andy Rice, who needs little introduction in this forum since he is truly one of the stalwart voices. You might even soon become a gray hair if you keep working at it, Andy. An eminence grise of deal making. He's one of the senior partners of the Jordan Company, a $10 billion organization in Chicago where he is based. Andy has done more deals than any human being that I know in China. He's done 30-something of them, 25 or so of which were in connection with U.S. or other acquisitions that the Jordan Company has made, where they have sought through their own entrepreneurship and innovation as stewards of companies to expand east, to find benefits in the great rising economy that is China in today's globe. He is as American in some ways as you might assume. Look at his own background, degrees in engineering, both BS and MS in engineering from New Mexico State University, but then he goes off to Australia to get further graduate training, where he was a Rotary Fellow at the University of Melbourne. And he's globetrotted to China, and more recently has expanded the footprint from China to Greater Asia. Probably, I think we'll hear from Andy, that maybe some of the original motivations for focusing so acutely on China really became an Asian story as labor markets broadened and as labor efficiencies broadened. Harvey Fine is a good friend from a wonderful organization that is everywhere present in the financial press these days. It's FOSIN. And Harvey heads the US M&A team, reporting to Patrick Zhang, who has also been a good member of this organization, as has Harvey. And they are on a global acquisition spree, acquiring everything from insurance businesses in the United States and in Europe, including the largest insurer in Portugal, to Club Med, which was a bit of a dogfight to get control of the world's leisure class. And then, if that weren't interesting enough, they head up to Canada, where they recently acquired Cirque du Soleil. So you try to figure out what is the theme running through that. It's a lot of different things, but one theme is it's surely global. And I think Harvey, as an American trained graduate of the University of Pennsylvania Wharton School, has taken that training everywhere possible, and I think probably lives in airports. You may be the figure from up in the air soon if you keep working at it. On my right is a client, a friend, a counselor, and somebody who has done it all. Bert Notini is originally a lawyer, partner, senior partner in Hale and Dorr, one of the really best law firms in America, now called WilmerHale. Bert later became an executive, first at Wang Laboratories. He later was chief financial officer of Manufacturer Services, a company we represented years ago and merged into Celestica, one of the great contract manufacturers that that is a global business if ever there was. He later became president of Sonos Networks, also became a client of ours. You can see why I like having Bert on a panel. I mean, whatever you need to do to keep the client happy. But and he later became chairman of Aptus and Ironbow, which are aerospace defense and government contracting businesses controlled by New Mountain, where Bert is New Mountain Capital, a $12 billion private equity fund that we also represent and where Bert is a partner. So he's done it all, lawyering, banking, executive management, and investing. New Mountain tends to be more domestic focused. I'm tempted to say their idea of going global is having a passport, but I think it's more apt to say their idea of going global is going to London, which isn't really going global. It's the 51st state. I think they will go global as they emerge. They certainly have gone global in their investor base because they're so damn good at what they do that they're top quartile players, so therefore pensions and sovereigns and others around the globe want to put money to work with them, and they no doubt have companies that, what happened? Did I start shouting? Okay. And finally, Florian Funk is a director of EQT, which is a great private equity organization, originally European, but now as global as one can get there. Their anchor tenant investor has long been the Wallenberg family, which many of you will know are among Europe's most storied and successful investors in a broad range of companies from ABB to AB Investor, to across the entire spectrum, buyouts, growth capital, and venture, and have also been leaders in bringing corporate executives to their task. Some 250 of them are really partners in one form or another of the organization in trying to build businesses. So this is a global panel. Let me start with a global question. We sit here today, as David mentioned, in an economy in which, strangely, large cap US earnings are softening. Harder to show growth on the top line because foreign currencies have to be reported back into dollars. We sit in a moment in time when the U.S. may be one of the better, in fact, probably is the best of the developed growth economies. The financial crisis may have been made in America, but so is the recovery. That's probably because we have what Valerie Giscard d'Estaing called an exorbitant privilege of being the reserve currency, but that's only because we're the biggest economy. So we must be doing something right. But so it's hard to be global in that context. Europe is stagnating, Chinese growth is slowing, and Andy probably is looking at broader Asia because Chinese growth is slowing and labor markets are expanding to be cheaper in countries in Asia other than China. And Chinese debt is expanding at an alarming rate. And in the meantime, the BRICS, BRIC was supposed to be an acronym for something as solid as a rock or as a brick, right? Brazil, Russia, India, China, they don't look so solid after that acronym. We might have called them the Cribs. We could have made that acronym too. But somehow or other, the world as we know it is changing rapidly. Where are we in the global geopolitical scene? Let me start with you, Andy, and give us a little bit of a sense of things.
Well, my focus is China and Asia. And you know, the headline news in China is often very different than what's happening on the ground. Is the mic on? Yeah, there we go. It's often very different from what's happening. But it is true when you're growing at 8 or 10% a year and things slow to 6 or 7%, there's built-up capacity and that rumbles through the economy. More importantly, though, our labor rates are doubling every 5 years. It's much more expensive in China. From a technology viewpoint, China has more productivity gains than any country in the world. There are actually more workers that are being laid off by Chinese companies due to productivity than laid off because of, you know, reduced exports, etc. For a lot of those reasons, we're starting to look at Asia outside China because of the growth markets. China's one-child policy. The demographics are going in the wrong direction in China. You know, you look at Vietnam and other parts of Southeast Asia, you have 60-70% of the population's under age 35. So we're starting to look more at those markets, and I think we're going to see more and more trends in that direction, where China's still important. It's becoming more of a domestic market. But the headlines are always, different than when you're over there, what's happening.
Right? And Andy, you had mentioned to me that the block that is now referred to as ASEAN is becoming increasingly important. Tell us a little bit about ASEAN and why that's important.
The ASEAN Economic Community, AEC, is the 10 Southeast Asian countries. You know, it's the 10 you think of, Singapore, Malaysia, Burma, or Myanmar, Thailand, Vietnam, Philippines, Indonesia, etc. They have been working for 8 years on forming a common market, which actually kicks in at the end of this year. It's modeled over the European community, but there's no plans to have a common currency.
I think they got the memo that that doesn't work out so well.
So, but at the end of this year, almost all tariffs among those 10 countries are going to be eliminated. And they're working eventually on the free movement of people and the capital flow. But I was in Vietnam in December, and there are thousands of Chinese companies setting up factories in Vietnam because they have tariffs of 5 to 10% when they export to those other 10 countries. And so they want to be inside the 10. And so you're already seeing dramatic changes. You're also seeing Fortune 500 companies that are investing to be manufacturing in Southeast Asia to take advantage of this.
And that will lead to mid-sized companies from the U.S. and Europe that are going to follow their the bigger companies that they make products for. So I think, you know, some of those trends are very real and there will be investment opportunities.
So the free movement of both money and labor are good themes. Now, Harvey, you've got the free movement of money from China, and you're acquiring businesses whose employees are in many different forms of economic activity, from financial services to tourism. Tell us a little bit about the geopolitical scene as you see it from the perch of Fosun, which speaks for, by my calculations, some $50 billion worth of corporate assets and has been on an M&A tear, outbidding even robust acquirers of companies like KKR in the case of Club Med. Tell us a little bit about how you look at the world today economically.
Right. We think there are growth opportunities in the U.S. and Europe, but one of our strategies for going global is that we think there's opportunities to invest in mature companies in their home markets, so in the U.S. and Europe, that are established but have growth opportunities in China. So I agree with what Andy's saying about China no longer being a manufacturer for the world, right? Even Chinese companies are outsourcing to Vietnam and Southeast Asia. But there's several opportunities in China. One is that it's becoming a consumer market and still has room to grow because the GDP in China is about, per capita, $6,500. So that ranks right around Iraq and Namibia, which is in Africa. I can't even find where that country is. And the Czech Republic is three times the GDP of per capita of China. So there's obviously a lot of room to grow. As income has risen, and that's the reason why you're seeing workers, manufacturing go overseas, the purchasing power of the Chinese is increasing. So even the one-child policy has a benefit for that because China is also not only one of the largest, highest saving rates among countries, but it's also one of the highest consumption rates because they have a whole family that's saving and consuming. So the purchasing is now global. So when we look at the Chinese consumer, we feel like with our existing Chinese resources, we're already tapping into the high-end Chinese consumer, right? White-collar workers, people who have interests in foreign goods and services and have the financial means to consume them. And we want to provide a full life cycle of the type of products and services they want. Everything from their healthcare needs to their wealth management to their insurance needs, the content they consume, the clothes they buy, where they travel. Some of those businesses will be based in China, but some of them will also be foreign companies that we think we can help bring into China and access that Chinese.
So you're pointing to, Harvey, as I suspected you might, one of the sub-themes in our conversation, which is this notion that it's not just deals that we are doing, but it's actual participation in a real economy, and it's the bringing of goods and services to people that you really focus on. Now, that doesn't take away your profit motive at all. I think your profit motive is spectacular and highly successful. But this notion of looking at the world as a source of goods and services that you can bring to a rising middle class whose per capita income remains weak. And it's probably, I think, the most important fact about China is that for all of its prowess and growth as an aggregate matter, its per capita income is actually quite low. If it is below the Czech Republic by a factor of three, it is low, and it has been for all these years. So it has a ways to go, and you're trying to make that happen. Florian, I want to turn to you since Harvey mentioned something about Europe. He at least mentioned the Czech Republic, which is maybe in your distant backyard as a German national. I was curious when you told me that you were representing money that has originally been backed by the Wallenbergs, although I know it's broadened out considerably. I was curious that you came to the U.S. because I would have thought that 0 to 0.2% growth rates in Europe would suggest that at some point around now there might be an opportunity to just focus on European companies. Why is European money that you represent wanting to come to the United States?
Yeah, sure, let me comment on that. First of all, I have to say we are all very bullish on the U.S. market. I think there's a great pool of fascinating companies. We're looking forward to build those and bring them, if possible, also outside the U.S., but we're also happy to build them within the U.S. But before I speak about the motivation, about why we also think that we will be able to create a lot of value in the U.S., two words on Europe. I think it's an interesting and complicated space these days. You have to differentiate also by region, and you cannot make a mistake then to put every European country in one bag. We are very focused on Northern Europe, which is Scandinavia and the German region. There are a lot of businesses which, despite the sideways on the macro environment, are doing quite well. So we continue to push in Europe and are very bullish also investing there and finding good businesses to invest into. Finally, regarding coming back to the U.S., we've been here since 2008 with our infrastructure business line. We've done six investments out of that fund, and those have been worked out quite well. What we bring to the U.S. And what has made EQT successful over the past 20 years, I think, is a very clear approach to governance. creating an environment for the management team to be very well supported out of our industrial advisor network. The majority of our boards typically is comprised out of people with 20, 30 years of industrial knowledge, so not so much driven by us, the investment managers, which is supporting a environment where we can go for the full potential of those companies. And then in addition, as we engage in the discussion with entrepreneurs here in the US, it is clear that a lot of them have still a lot of room to grow within the US market, but there are definitely interesting opportunities for them to grow outside. And as we are established in the meantime in Asia as well, not only Europe, we think we can help them to go outside the US and build businesses being organically or also via bolt-on M&A acquisitions. So we're looking very much forward to that, and the initial discussions I had with entrepreneurs so far suggest that this model is welcome.
By the way, I might have mentioned in my introduction, Flory, that while you're European, now based in the US, you've also had considerable experience in China and Asia.
Yeah, absolutely. I've spent 2.5 years in our Hong Kong office, where we have 3 offices, Shanghai, Hong Kong, and Singapore. And I fully agree, we also have to look outside of China. They're very interesting economies in the southeastern part of Asia. Maybe we can debate in the next round of questions around deal doing in those regions, because that is, again, I think, a different story and brings up some challenges. Only because the macroeconomic environment is positive, economies are growing 7-8%, doesn't mean that doing M&A in those countries is necessarily very easy.
Exactly the topic we'll get to in a moment, but I first want to ask Bert, picking up on something Florian just talked about, governance and the role of operating partners. I teach a class on private equity for the last 7 or 8 years at Columbia, and one of the themes in my course is that understanding leverage finance and financial markets is a necessary but not sufficient ingredient to success as an investor, that you really do have to understand these things called human enterprises, these things called companies. And I think, Bert, you, if I may say it, you're a friend and a client and really a counselor to companies from your legal, financial, and operating background. You personify, I think, the very essence of looking at businesses as a strategic and operating matter. Talk a little bit about the global economic scene, why you guys are generally more comfortable with U.S. investing, although you now have businesses overseas anyway. You certainly have businesses whose employees are everywhere overseas. But talk a little bit about the global economic scene from the perspective of somebody who understands what it means to operate a company. You're now an investor, but you've been there.
Yeah. I appreciate that, Marshall. It's for this audience, it was pretty sophisticated, so I was trying to think what's the right lens on it. So let me take it from a lens of where I sit today as part of a U.S.-based private equity fund where we have investors recently in our new fund that are significantly from outside the U.S., so that's different. If you look at the returns of the last several vintage of private equity across the industry, what you see is that, and you know this, Marshall, that the returns are heavily weighted to operational improvement as opposed to maybe 10, 15 years ago, where the returns are heavily weighted to did you buy it right? Did you get multiple expansion? Did you get leverage? There's no more multiple expansion. Everybody's overpaying. Everybody's got the same leverage package. And so therefore, the only thing left is operations. So that operational piece becomes extremely important, I think you've mentioned as well. So I think the context of then how do you take that and put it to work from a capital point of view, I think we see through our portfolio companies, about 20 of them, all of whom have operations internationally, getting close to the ground and being able to help drive the operating discipline with advisor networks, with the people on the ground is the big difference for us. And I'd say, at least as we think about it, we move beyond an international cross-border M&A deals from the headline, hey, wow, I'm doing a deal in some far off place that I never heard of before, to this is real business now. We got to drive real returns. And it's one thing to get into it, the other thing is how do you get out of it. And so that earnings expansion to us matters a lot.
You talk about getting out of it, you mean either listing companies or selling companies, and maybe if your companies are in other jurisdictions, that may not be as simple a process.
That's right. From a sponsor point of view, unlike, say, strategic, where you can own it, you're building a market, you hope to be there for 20 years, we have to get in, we have to get out within an investment horizon. So we have to have a look that's 10 years out, we have to figure out how we're going to exit within 5. And I will say, from a global economy point of view, from that perspective, it does feel sort of choppy. It's a little hard right now to think through all of the rhythms out there in the global economy.
The other thing I would say about New Mountain is it tends to be a little bit less leverage driven than some of the other firms. I put it more in the bucket of a Warburg Pincus. Ironically, or maybe it's not so ironic, your original training was as a restructuring lawyer, so you've seen what leverage can do to companies on the downside, and you ended up joining a private equity firm that is more interested in operational enhancements than burdening the company. Florian, going back to EQT with your Wallenberg base, are you a little bit longer and more patient as capital, or are you more like all other, most other funds in horizon and leverage?
No, I mean, if you look at the value creation over the past 20 years, 95% of that came from sales improvement and margin improvement, and only 5% from debt pay down. I think that gives you a notion of our culture and our focus. We are a very growth-focused and very ambitious group of people. So for sure, we have a very high sense of urgency in the companies that we own. We are in regular dialogue with the CEO, but to support him, not to interrupt him. We want to make the CEO the hero who's running the show, who's running the operations. But he should get all the support that he needs to really fully exploit the potential of the company that he has in front of
him. Well, we're migrating naturally to the topic, Florian, that you put on the table a moment ago, which is the subject of M&A. Let me turn now. You'll notice, by the way, I put my folks who are focused on Asia on my left and my Westerners on my right, although I think at the end we're going to scramble the eggs pretty effectively. But Harvey, Fosun is not a private equity fund. You're the only one up here who is not. You might be a little bit more like the old-fashioned holdco, like a Berkshire Hathaway or a Virgin Group. A holdco privately held that owns many different businesses. To my knowledge, you've never sold anything, nor had Berkshire for the longest time. You buy things. Tell us a little bit about holding pattern, where you see M&A opportunities, and how you think about your role as a steward of a company from a time horizon, leverage, or other perspective. What are the metrics for you as a different kind of investor?
We tend to like to look at investments relatively long term, because we think that China's market still has a lot of room to grow. And we invest out of three pools of capital, like balance sheet. We do manage third-party funds, some of which are real estate, venture, private equity, and then we have insurance assets. So effectively, we look at opportunities where the companies have brands, business models, expertise, technology that are differentiated and not easily replicated that we think we can bring into the Chinese marketplace. And regardless of the type of capital structure, if it's fixed income investment, then we can invest out of our insurance asset. If it's a private equity investment, we can invest out of our funds and balance sheet. If it's a greenfield opportunity, we'll invest out of our balance sheet. So we're agnostic as to the part of the capital structure that we invest in. We're just looking for the right type of opportunities. In terms of the sectors that we look at, it's really revolving around the changing lifestyle of the Chinese consumer. Right? As I mentioned before, we think that this growing wealth within the middle class wants to consume products globally. They want to participate in the global community. And the changing lifestyle includes things like retail and luxury. China's quickly becoming the largest luxury market in the world, but 60% of that spend is actually outside of China. So it's important to have products and services outside
of China. Do you mean spent outside of China in the sense that the consumer went abroad and spent the money someplace else, or do you mean the brand was a European or American brand of luxury products?
They physically spend outside of mainland China. So you know, part of our investment thesis is investing in the parent company, because to capture the Chinese market is not just about the Chinese job itself. Look, it's about the Chinese traveler going there, which is why we invested in Club Med, which is why we invested in Thomas Cook Traveler, CITS, the largest Chinese travel agency. The changing consumer lifestyle is also about their healthcare needs, right? There's a larger elderly population that's happening, so we invested in senior care facilities. We continue to invest in healthcare technology, hospitals in China. We look at content, because we think content is also very global and apolitical, and that's something that, again, as the Chinese consumer wants to participate in the global stage, and increasing technology, because we're talking a little bit about the digital era. Well, we've seen China go from in 2005, 100 million internet users to well over 700 internet users. Mobile from 3 million to 600 million with about a 37% penetration rate. So this technology has allowed a Chinese consumer who may not have ever traveled outside of China, just keep in mind only 3% of the Chinese population actually hold passports, may not have ever traveled outside of China, but are very aware of global products and services. So this rapid change in Chinese lifestyle has allowed Western products and services to become something that's meaningful to them. What we want to be able to capture that element of the various segments within that consumer, whether it's healthcare, whether it's entertainment and media, whether it's travel and leisure, whether it's retail and luxury.
And you're mentioning lots of different service-oriented businesses, but Andy, I think you tend to, correct me if I'm mistaken, but I think you tend to focus a little more on the manufacturing side. Tell us, from an M&A practitioner's perspective, why manufacturing, why Greater Asia, and where do you see opportunity going forward, either by sector or geography?
Well, our focus has been manufacturing and distribution. And just to tie in some technology, we're not investing in technology companies in China. However, technology is a large enabler of a lot of new opportunities. I'll give you one example. In the U.S., there's a lot of companies that manufacture parts for industry or consumer goods that you can order it today, it's delivered by UPS the next day. In China, that was not possible until 1 or 2 years ago. So Alibaba, for instance, if they had a service where you'd order something and get it the next day, they had thousands of their own trucks, so they're asset heavy. So they had their own trucks and drivers going around doing this. Now, because of the improved infrastructure of air, you know, more airlines with cargo holds underneath, the highways are better. Now you're starting to see logistics firms like UPS, where a company can get an order, and then UPS comes in, picks up the package, delivers it the next day. So we're looking at that as consolidation opportunities, because China has many, many industries where there's one company that only serves one city because they logistically couldn't, you know, economically cover. Well, now that same company can get an order 1,000 miles away and efficiently, you know, deliver to that customer. So there's opportunities to acquire a bunch of these little companies serving a niche, put it together, you get all the economies of scale, you get cross-selling. And we're seeing, I think that's going to be one of the big investment themes in China over the next 10 years are local or regional companies that have an opportunity to expand nationally. And it's kind of like the U.S. 25 years ago.
I hope the audience will forgive me in lieu of Q&A. I'll give the last couple of minutes for our panel to my slightly more American-centric investors. Florian, you touched on what's important from an M&A practitioner's perspective today. What do you think is important?
It's a good question. The current environment, definitely it's a very frothy market out there. A lot of buyers have very high expectations when they are selling companies, given the leverage market right now.
Is this a seller's market more than a buyer's market?
I think so. At least what I've seen so far in the U.S. and Europe, it definitely is.
Moderating a panel at Harvard on Friday, and one of my panelists was a very good friend of mine named Barry Goldberg, who'd been a partner at Goldman Sachs, head of private equity, for running a fund called Crestview, and he told the room they sold 8 companies last year and bought none. He's a pretty smart guy. This is a somewhat frothy market. We've got a lot of cheap money. You came here with money to invest, but I wonder about that right now.
No, I think there are still opportunities. You have to be smart about it. It's not necessarily the full auction where you will find the right companies. We, our 50% of our portfolio in the mid-market stays in Europe and Asia, where we are partnering up with founders and entrepreneurs. They are not only looking for maximizing the value based on the current transaction, but they have also a long-term perspective. So who will be able to really help me to bring that business to the next level? And then you have a whole different kind of discussion with that person and that seller. Of course, if you have just a financial seller, he is only purely about price maximization. And then it's the question, are we differentiated enough? And what is the company needing going forward? If we can address what the company needs, then we are the right buyer. But otherwise, it's very difficult right now to buy a very good business at high prices. What we are ready to do, But right now, what I've seen so far are more mediocre businesses which expect a price tag for a high-quality business. And then, of course, it's a complete mismatch, and then you rather have to stay extremely disciplined and observe the market and be more creative about finding the right.
And Bert, with our non-remaining time, I want to make the last couple of words substantively to you. What matters now in terms of areas to focus for an M&A buyer of companies or seller?
I would say for us on the buy side and the sell side, I will say our advisor network matters a lot to us. So, you know, the way you help
like
us, guys like you.
Love it.
You know, and why? Because, you know, it's all playing within the seams. What we bring to the table is speed and certainty in areas that we know well and we've drilled down in well. So it's really critical for us to get deals done and even to get good exits to be brought together with the right seller or the right buyer that values that a lot. And also then underneath it, some operating support, some ability to enter into some new markets, whether it's Europe to the US or US then broadening out. That's what matters from us as a practitioner trying to, you know, be in the business of putting capital to work, having those opportunities within our sweet spots is really the thing that matters.
Well, folks, our time is up, but we had promised you a global perspective that would scramble eggs. I hope you feel we delivered. Florian Funk, the erudite director of EQT, thank you. Andy Rice, the stalwart of the Jordan Company and Globetrotter, thank you so much as always. Harvey Fine, relative newcomer from Fosun Group and a very important practitioner of the business of buying and selling companies, more buying in your case, thank you so much. And the incomparable Bert Notini, my friend and client from New Mountain Capital, thank you all, and thank you to the audience for hearing us.